Good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome you to worship, especially any visitors who might be with us in the sanctuary, or now we know we have visitors on our live stream from other states even. We're grateful for people who come to worship in both of those ways, that we might hear God's word and respond in faith. Our broadcast, or a half-hour portion of our broadcast, will be our worship service will be rebroadcast on the radio station later today at 11:30. We thank Kay and Bob Wright, who are sponsoring that this morning in memory of Ken and Carol Ponder. We've been, as pastors and staff, we've been grateful for your abiding by the safety guidelines of masks and distancing and other things that have helped, we think, keep this a safe place to gather. I did want to announce that starting next Sunday, we think it'll be okay to start singing together in the sanctuary. Let's this Sunday still refrain from that, but next Sunday, we'll say it this way, we'll softly sing to the music, with the mask, of course. Just highlighting a few things about our week, this coming week. It is the week we're going to put together our newsletter for the month of May. So if you have anything you would like to add to that newsletter, please have that in to the church office by tomorrow. Our Circle Bible Study, we'll be having their monthly Bible study on Thursday, and that can be attended either in person in the social hall or by Zoom. And if you can't get that link off of the Facebook page, you could call the church office and we can email that to you. I want to explain that next Sunday we're going to have First Communion Sunday, but we're also going to have First Communion Sunday the following Sunday. We have such a large class, and because of the social distance guidelines, we're going to have half the class next Sunday and then the remainder of the class the first Sunday of May. So we'll be having communion here the next two Sundays and celebrating with those fifth graders and their families their invitation to partake more fully in the worship service. You have an opportunity to support the St. James Fire Department this morning if you'd like. There is a breakfast, drive-through fundraiser, but the meal I see is also able to be delivered, so you could look up the bulletin on our website and get that phone number if you'd like to have that even delivered to you. I'll leave the rest of the announcements to your reading and ask that you now stand and let us turn to a time of confession.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Together, we join in our opening hymn, hymn number 367.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship.
God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin.
Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Time has come for our stories for God's children. And I have with me this morning a little pinwheel here. Borrowed it from Erin. She has lots of cool things in her office here at church. So thanks, Erin. But do you know how this pinwheel works? Hey, it just kind of sits here, doesn't really do anything on its own, but then, when there's a wind, either from outside or from someone blowing on it with their breath, it starts to go. These pinwheels are kind of like miniature versions of something much bigger that we might see around here. We've got a few pictures here. Got some wind turbines, right? Those spin around, make electricity for people to use in their homes and businesses. Maybe you've seen one of these windmills out at the farm, pumping water, use it, harnessing that wind, do some good work. This might be a little less familiar, but over in Holland, you got some windmills harnessing the power of the wind to mill grain and other things. But they don't do that on their own. They use that wind. The wind comes first and spins that around just like our little mini pinwheel here, and it reminds me of our story that we're going to hear this morning from the book of Acts, because we hear about the disciples, Peter and John, and they heal a man who's never walked before, and they tell him to stand up and walk, but they don't do it by their own power. They heal this man in Jesus' name. And that reminds me of this pinwheel, because there's a source. And for us, there's a source too. See, everything that we get to do comes first from God. So when we remember sort of pinwheel or those windmills that we looked at today, we remember that everything that we get to say and we get to do first comes from being filled up by God's love and forgiveness. Let's pray. God, we thank you that in Jesus' name we are forgiven and healed, and that because you fill us with your love and forgiveness, we get to go out and share that love with others. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. The first reading is from Acts chapter 3. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people. "You Israelites, why do you ponder at this? Or why do you stare at us? though by our own power or piety we had made him walk. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the face that is through Jesus has given him his perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that this Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and return to God, so that your sins may be wiped up. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 4. Answer me when I call, O God of my right. You gave me room when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. How long, you people, shall my honor suffer shame? How long will you love vain words and seek after lies? But know that the Lord has set apart the faithful for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. When you are disturbed, do not sin. Ponder it on your beds and be silent. Offer right sacrifices and you put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, oh, that we might see some good. Let the light of your face shine on us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart, more than when their grain and wine abound. I will both lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, O Lord, make me lie down in safety. The second reading is from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that this is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia verse.
Gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory
to you, O Lord. Jesus stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Seated. This morning, we continue our exploration in the book of Acts. And I mentioned to Pastor Andy this morning that we don't have a title for our series here in the season of Easter of preaching from Acts, but I think we really missed an opportunity to in not naming this series "Give Them the Axe." But we'll continue on anyway. And as Pastor Andy introduced last Sunday, we are in a time after Jesus' resurrection. Jesus has already appeared to his disciples for 40 days, and he has ascended into heaven. As he promised, he sent the Holy Spirit of God to descend upon the disciples in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. And in the power of God's Holy Spirit, the disciples have preached to the people who are gathered there in every language imaginable, so that the good news about Jesus Christ has been spreading in the city. And as we heard last Sunday, people are taking notice. Many are beginning to meet in homes to pray and to worship together, sharing meals, providing for each other. Others have also been taking notice, like the high priests and the Sadducees, who are beginning to realize that their plan to get rid of Jesus by killing him has backfired. But before we talk about what the Apostle Peter has to say here in Acts chapter 3, let's see what he does. The Apostle Peter and John are in the temple praying and preaching salvation in Jesus Christ when they see a man who has from birth never been able to walk. His friends have carried him to the temple gates and laid him there so that he may beg for money and perhaps survive another day. When Peter and John see him, they do not avoid him, but they seek him out. They engage him, and expecting to receive some money from them, the man gives them his full attention. But Peter tells him, "We have no money, but what we have, we will give. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." Lifting him up to his feet, this is the split second where anything can happen. Will he be able to stand? To walk? Or will he fall to the ground as quickly as they let go? This split second is the difference between madness and miracle. And in that brief moment, in the blink of an eye, so rapid that we can't see what happens in the name of Jesus Christ, this man stands and walks as he has never before. Then Peter and John and their newly healed friend begin to walk together in the temple, and people who know the man see him. They see him as they have never seen him before. They see him face to face, eye to eye. They see him standing and walking and jumping up and down and praising God, and they can hardly believe their own eyes. Is this the same man who for 40 years could not walk? Who lay on the ground and begged at the gate of the temple? They are amazed. And Peter seizes upon this opportunity of their amazement to tell them exactly what has happened. This man has been healed, but it has not been by Peter or John. It has not been done by any earthly power at all, but it has been done by the power of God. That this man, whom they have known for so long, is now healed. And then Peter's tone seems to shift. This man has been healed, but not by me. He has been healed in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. You remember him, don't you? The innocent man you turned over to the authorities on false charges. The one you begged Pilate to crucify, crying out to release the criminal Barabbas instead of him. The one you hung on a tree to die. But God had other plans. God raised him from the dead, and salvation comes through him. Regardless of the fact that the people who are listening here are unlikely the same exact people as those who had done such things, Peter is not condemning for the sake of condemning. Because there is so much more at stake. There is still time. And there is still a chance for all of us. He says, repent, and your sins will be wiped away. But remember who is speaking here. This is Peter, the close friend of Jesus, who just over a month ago had denied Jesus three times, who ran away fearing for his own life when Jesus needed him the most, when he was dying on the cross. Peter was nowhere to be found. So if Peter's voice sounds harsh, remember this. He is not speaking as one who has moral superiority here. Peter is speaking as the voice of experience, of one who needs forgiveness, of one who turns toward God in repentance, of one who receives God's grace, and in that grace also receives God's call by the Holy Spirit to continue the work that Jesus had begun. Because you see, the temple was supposed to be the place where the sick and the poor could go to find some relief and care in a world that seemed to keep brushing them off. And that is how God had intended it to be from the beginning, that it would be a beacon of hope for a world so desperately in need. Perhaps it was for a while. But now here is a man whose 40 years of begging at its gate stands as evidence among so many other examples of the people who have been failed throughout history, failed by community and institutions, religious or otherwise. When those communities and institutions have made self-preservation their only concern, but the message of Acts is different. The message of Acts is that God's holy temple is not a building at all. It's not a place. God's temple is God's people. God's people made holy by Jesus and the Holy Spirit. God's temple is you. When Peter tells us to repent, he is speaking just as Jesus did. Not so that we would live lives full of remorse or regret. Not so that we would retreat from the world into some kind of spiritual realm of being apart from the world. But so that encountering the living Christ in the world, we would experience a complete transformation of our hearts and our minds. So that everything, our everyday activities, our relationships, our habits, the way that we engage the people around us and around the world, everything in our lives, that they would find their meaning and purpose in Jesus Christ. Peter is saying, and will continue to proclaim until his dying breath, that it's our turn. Our turn to look in the mirror, to hold ourselves accountable to the communities that we belong to repent and to receive this whole new way of seeing the world, the way that God sees the world, with nothing but love and a sense of responsibility for all that God has created, to continue Christ's work. Like the man who was healed in Jesus' name, who stood up for the very first time in his life and saw the world from a completely new angle, you are forgiven. You are healed. You have received new life in Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Enlightened by God's word, let us confess with one voice our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Let us stand to do this. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
In our prayers today, I'll be including a friend of ours, Pastor Kathy McDonald, who died this morning. Alive in the risen Christ, with the power of the Holy Spirit, let us bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us. Each petition will end, "Hear us, O God." Our response is, "Your mercy is great." Living God, even in the midst of the Easter message, we live with questions and wonderings. Open our hearts and minds as we hear your word. May we believe it day by day and be your witnesses in this world with our words and deeds. Hear us, O God. Creating God, you have fashioned the universe out of your love and delight. Provide for your creation that life may be sustained. We pray that we may be good stewards of our properties as individuals and of our communities, that we may, with our communities, may care for our parks and water and land. Change us, O Lord, when needed to preserve creation, rather than asking creation to always adapt to our desires. Hear us, O God. God of all, our nation is troubled by recent events. Comfort the families of loved ones lost in the killings in Indianapolis. Guide the jury who deliberates this week in Minneapolis as the nation watches. We lift up the family of Dante Wright. We pray for Kim Potter. We ask for peaceful protests. May we as a nation become better in ways of living together and growing in trust and justice. Let your guidance, Lord, be known. Hear us, O Lord. Healing God, you hear the cries of those in need and answer them in distress. Grant to those who are ill or suffering your compassion. And we name these: Bruce Bakke, Treva Basil, Sarah Belke, Fern Branstead, Glenda Cross, Ruthann Danger, Wayne Gersh, Ken Henderson, Don Holmquist, Rusty Canock, Cindy Malone, Hannah Ulrich, Mary Meyer, Patty Mixel, Gary Miller, Amira Norland, Ruth Olson, Bob Paulson, Natalie Paulson, Michael Ratzloff, Erica Rodriguez, Ryan Romley, Natasha Schiffler, Julie Schiller, Tom Sparks, Betty Stevens, Sandy Sundy, Evan Winkleman, Eldon Wright, Everett Wright, Rita Zollers. Hear us, O God. Loving God, we desire to raise our children in the Christian faith. We rejoice that we will have a more full, we'll have more participating in your table of Holy Communion in the next couple Sundays. May their participation deepen their faith, and may they more fully understand and live under your grace. Hear us, O God. Give your church guidance as we still work toward doing ministry in this time of pandemic. Bless the many working to vaccinate the population. Grant respite to medical workers and others who have borne a great burden. May we become a healthier world by your help and by our safe behavior. Hear us, O God. God of all times and ages, we pray for those for whom death is near, that they may trust you in all things. We remember the life of Pastor Kathy McDonald with thanksgiving. Assure us of the peace you have promised, that we all may be ready to meet the end of our life whenever that may come. Hear us, O God. We raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated for our offerings today. We give you thanks for those who have brought offerings and put them in the offering plate in the gathering space, or for those who are electronically giving offerings even now. We also have an offering of song.
Yeah.
Please stand as we conclude our service. Let us pray. God of love, we do ask that you inspire us for the work of ministry, and may the offerings that you first gave us help us to do that ministry, both here and in faraway places, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our concluding song is 389.
Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.